Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to a roundtable here in American Air Gunner. I'm joined by the godfather of air guns, Jim Chapman and Rick Usler. Guys, today we are talking buying used air guns. I know there's a lot of that, and even like hand-me-downs. Now, I personally have a strict rule. Never buy an air gun. You should just get them from the sponsors of your show. But if that doesn't work for everyone else,
that's my rule.
Steal them out of
a steal them from you guys. When you're talking about, I mean, we go to, you throw a gun show. We go to tons of gun shows, and people are wheeling and dealing, and even sometimes passing down old guns. What's the best way to, or the biggest thing to look for when you're buying a used air gun? Let's start with you.
Okay. What I do is stay with brands I know. And you may think I know all about air guns, but I don't.
There's
a lot of brands out there I'm not familiar with, Rossi, and I just don't buy them used. Because I don't know what could go wrong with them. But the ones I know, I pretty much know how to check them out. Mm-hmm. If I'm allowed to shoot them, which is the best of all things, then I cock them, I shoot them, I listen to them, and I can get a pretty good idea of what's going on. If I'm not allowed to shoot them, then I at least go over them and I look for the common faults that I know with those guns, but not all guns, might be wrong. And the last thing I do is I buy it right. So if the doggone thing needs to be completely rebuilt, at least I've got a good shell there. I can afford to rebuild it.
Okay, so if you buy a used air gun and you do want to get it worked on, what's the best place to get it worked on?
Well, it depends on the gun, obviously, as always. Some manufacturers actually have service departments that you can send it back in and have it worked on. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of different garage businesses or small businesses that will take an air gun and tune it up. Usually if you buy a used gun, you may want to have it tuned anyway. The one thing I was going to say, Tom, is that it always helps to know who you're buying it from.
Oh, yeah.
So if the person has a good reputation, sort of like on eBay, they have the good reputation.
Sure.
There are people that have good reputations, and there are people that you want to avoid. Mm-hmm. And if you get on the forums and some of the people that are selling the guns, you can tell very quickly if they've, not been terribly truthful in the past, and people will avoid them.
Yeah, when I buy air guns, mostly the used guns I bought have been PCPs. And I'm usually buying them online. So I go to one of the forums you mentioned. One of the forums, the Yellow Forum, has a board of inquiry, for instance, where the seller, his track record is published. So if he sold 10 guns, you can look to see what the experience was. Yeah. But if I'm at a gun show and I'm looking at guns, I spend a lot of time looking at just the general condition of the gun. A gun that's been thrashed has been thrashed. And it might not be correct, but I think if the outside looks bad, the inside probably doesn't look a lot better.
And listen to the seller when you're at the gun show. If the guy says, "This thing shoots real powerful. I cock it and shoot it all the time. Well, you got some pellets?" "Oh, no, I don't have any pellets for it." He's been dry firing it.
Yeah.
And they do that a lot. Mm-hmm. And that's not good for spring guns.
Yeah, you start running into...
Let's get specific. Okay, so before you do this, let's talk springers.
Sure.
I know this is where you're... What are common things you would see in an old gun or a misused gun?
One thing I really look for is see if the barrel's bent upwards.
Barrel drooping.
I like the barrel bent upwards because these Magnum springers, they'll cock it and it'll slip out of their hand. And the barrel will fly up and the barrel will go like that.
They say they slip out of their hand. You know that they are trying to see how quick the barrel will close when they pull the trigger.
But it's amazing. I ran a service department for about 14 months for a manufacturer here in the States. And I got them all the time, and they said, it was shooting great, and now, I'm just shooting 6 inches high. I'm like, all right, so who cocked it and let it slip? Well, that happened once. And they don't disclose that. So you really, if you look down the barrel and it's pointing upwards, you can pretty much bet that it's how
But
that
you
happened.
Can bend that barrel back because air gun barrels are dead soft. It a very simple fixture, which I blogged about a year ago, you can bend the barrel back straight. Mm. It's just a C-clamp.
Interesting.
So there's a way to save money, because if you find one that's a ski ramp, you say to the guy, "I'm not going to buy this unless you really want to sell it right."
Rick, what are we looking at here?
Well, this is some stuff that's inside the gun, and this goes back to what Tom was saying about being able to shoot it. You're not going to know if you're going to have this kind of damage.
What am I looking at here?
What is
kind of damage?
That is a seal on an internal piston, and that seal has been abused pretty thoroughly.
Okay, got cracks, chips, sure.
Well, it's got blow-by right there, so it's not going to have a good seal. You're not going to have the right velocity, and that is really heavily charged, so you can tell that one has been dieseling quite a bit.
What does dieseling mean for the lapers?
Dieseling is when that piston flies forward, you have tremendous heat and pressure. If there's any accelerant, any sort of petroleum-based lubricant has been introduced into that chamber, it's going to explode.
So we're creating heat and fire inside the air gun.
Yeah, and that just tears.
That can't be good.
And this is what happens. You get the blow-by, and it just ruins the gun.
Yeah. Okay, so this color and this black, that is actual fire.
That one's really good.
The other thing I've noticed, I don't know if you guys have seen it, but when I'm looking at a Springer and I'm at a place where I can shoot it, I cock it. Sometimes you get a gun that has a really rough cocking.
Gritty, yeah.
It's gritty,
yeah.
You know. Something's just not right.
Something's wrong.
And I've opened those up, and there have been springs that have been broken into multiple pieces. And you'll get that from kind of the smoothness of the mechanics, how everything's fitting and working together.
In the brand, you know, you mentioned brand, go back to that for a minute. There are some name brands that are good, like RWS is good, Y-Rock.
Yep. Valzer.
Yeah, and some of these that even if there are a little issues with them, the parts are available. You can rebuild them, and they're going to be probably worth the investment.
Okay, let's talk, because I would think the guns that probably get dealt the most and sold are PCPs. Those are expensive guns, so if I'm a first-time buyer, I might want to buy a used one. What do I need to look for there if I'm looking for a PCP?
Yeah, well, I mean, one of the things I looked is to see that it's holding air.
Yeah,
because that's a big thing is they can leak, and a lot of times people get frustrated with them because they have a slow leak. And often it's just something simple like an O-ring replacement. But I look, and if I'm looking at a gun in a gun show and it's empty, to me that sends up a warning sign.
Absolutely.
Right there, because they didn't empty it to come to the show. There should be some pressure.
Right, yeah.
So you want to make sure that it holds air. And then I do the same thing. I just look at the general condition. Mm-hmm. If I can, I'll go and I'll look at the air reservoir. If I can take it out of the stock, look to see if there's any wear and tear. I try to get an idea if somebody has opened this gun up before, if they tried to
look at the screws.
If they try to pull it apart.
Yeah. If the screws are boogered or if the pins have marks around their holes, somebody's had the gun apart.
Okay, and that's a bad thing.
Not a bad thing, but it's something to be concerned about.
Well, if you ask the owner, hey, have you maintained this gun? Right. Have you taken it apart? They say no. And you look at the side, and it's obvious that you can see the screws are tweaked. Then, you know.
Should you ever buy a used gun if you can't shoot it?
If you buy it right.
I do it when I'm buying online all the time, actually.
Sure, okay.
Yeah, and again, that's why it's good to know the credibility of the person you're buying from, that they've been on, if you go through the Board of Inquiry, because if somebody sells you a gun and they weren't honest about the wear and tear on it, you should be able to return it to them. If they're honest, and if I sell a gun, I take pictures of where the damage is. If there's a scratch, if there's a ding, if I've done something to it, something's been done, I'm very clear, and I hope to get that same type of honesty from the seller. And you often can.
As long as we're talking about buying online, look for things like blurry pictures, dark pictures, and pictures of the gun way off in the distance. That's a guy who's trying to hide something.
Okay.
And it happens all the time.
You're internet savvy. Yeah.
Then they say it happened in shipping. I don't know what happened. Yeah. When I shipped the gun, it was perfect. And it's bent into a pretzel.
Yeah, and rusted.
So not that any normal person watching the show is going to do this, but I'm curious. I'm just going to go to you. When you get one of your old guns, whether it's a hand-me-down or an old gun that you've acquired, what process do you put it through to get it in the working condition for you?
That's a great question.
Yeah, that's what I'm here for.
First thing you do, I do, is I look it over and see if it's right,
okay.
if it's ready to be shot. Second thing I do is I actually cock it, or I pressurize it or whatever. I load it, and I shoot it very carefully. Very carefully means I have eye protection on, and I'm watching for things that shouldn't happen that might.
Sure.
Okay. If the first shot's okay, I can pretty well tell they're all going to be okay. If the first shot's hinky, stop, because you got a problem somewhere. You might even find that problem while you're cocking the gun.
Okay.
From what Jim was saying.
So you don't automatically take it apart and put it through its steps?
That's the worst thing, and some guys do that. They even get brand new guns. They take them apart. They put them back together again, and then they start blasting the manufacturer.
Yeah, right.
Why doesn't this thing, you know, and the guy had the gun apart. He didn't even get it a chance.
Yeah, never shot it.
Give used guns a chance, too.
Really? That was my first thought. I thought you guys would take the gun apart, make sure it's all good.
As a critic.
I make sure it works first.
If
it works, leave it alone.
Because if it ain't broke,
right? I get the box in. I have now begun actually taking pictures of it coming out of the box. Things get damaged in shipping, not notice it. I had one gun come in, did not realize it had been damaged in shipping. My first shot blew the suppressor right out the front of the gun because the pellet clipped it. Mm. So,
nice.
So, but I, you know, I had taken pictures and found it afterwards. But I, now I document everything, and then I just start shooting the gun. It sometimes they're perfect, other times they're
with
not.
With the PCPs,
you have to really.
I'll fill them up and I'll leave them sitting for 2 or 3 days just to make sure they hold a charge. And, yep. And that's the first thing I do. And
so if, it's not like a fill up and then listen.
No,
like,
if I'm
gonna, it
if,
might be a
no,
slow.
No, a slow leak.
If you,
you
hear
won't
it,
see.
It's really
right. Speaking of listening, do not put your ear over the muzzle. Some
but
people
don't,
do that.
Don't, rule number three.
Yeah.
Don't be an idiot.
Yeah.
Take your hand, cup it beside the muzzle, and stick your ear up like this. If it goes off, it's at least not going to blow your eardrum out.
Yeah, but you know, if I think there's a slow leak, I may take the gun out of the stock and I'll put some dishwater soap around and see if it's blowing bubbles.
Okay.
And I'll check it out that way. But I check to make sure it's holding a charge. Often in a used gun, I'll go back and rework the trigger, though. That is something I'll do a lot because I found people a lot of times will set the trigger way lighter than I want in a hunting gun.
Oh, yeah.
They, you know, guys shooting target want a few ounce on the pull. And when I'm wearing gloves or I'm hunting with frostbitten fingers, I want something that takes a little bit of effort
to feel it,
to pull back, right? So I'll go back and reset it. But outside of that, I agree with you guys. Test it. If it works, leave it alone.
Last question. Do you guys have a go-to place for used air guns?
I like air gun shows, but I also shop Gun Broker, which is a gun retail auction site.
Okay.
Yeah.
I use the Yellow Forum and their Board of Inquiry. It's one of the big American air gun forums. Yeah.
We've all been on there.
People
send you guns.
I don't
you're
really.
You're not wasting time with used guns.
What I like to do is actually help people sell their used guns. So I'm working on a way to do that.
There you go. So air gun web.
Yeah.
All right, well, guys, there you go. So just be smart when you're buying used air guns. And, of course, try to buy from someone that you know, respect, and most importantly, do not take the air gun apart when you get it, which is exactly what I would do. All right, that's it for this roundtable. Check everything out, please, on AmericanAirGunner.com. We'll be right back with more American Air Gunner right after this. Interesting. I would have thought for sure you guys would take that apart.